Welcome to Bethel World Outreach Church. Our values are devotion, diversity, and discipleship. Devotion through honoring God by trusting His Word, praying, and worshiping together. Diversity by embracing God's heart for every nation. And discipleship by helping others follow Jesus. So join us as we're reaching a city to touch the world.
It is good to be in family and to be, you know, to be able to pause like that, have a moment like that. I just want to reiterate something Pastor Bryson talked about with the training with our pastor, Rice Brooks. I met him years ago. He doesn't like to say how many. He doesn't like me to say how many years, but just a few years ago. But he has developed some great tools and some great presentations. One of them is called the God Test, which is a little tool. It's 10 questions that we've used really around the world. I say we because we are family. Pastor Rice has that kind of an outreach as well, that kind of a global impact. You know, and one of the questions that we had, the first question, do you believe in God? You'll have to come to the training to get the whole of it. But some people will say no. And then we ask them, what are the main reasons? And they might say, well, you know, if there's a loving God, why is there so much evil in the world? That's a common response. You know, if God was all loving, then why doesn't He stop the evil? If He's all powerful, then He could, but apparently He's one or the other, not, you know, and so you can have kind of these crises of faith as we see what we see right now and what we see what could be. And as we've been studying the book of Daniel, the people of Daniel, if they were not paying attention, they could have had that crisis of faith. Why are we in captivity? You got to realize we've been in the book of Daniel for a few weeks now, and you know they were in captivity. And so you do have to kind of look at that reality for them. But there were multiple warnings given to Israel. If they would have paid attention, even from the days of Moses, you know, in the law in Deuteronomy, Moses, and he said, you know, if you don't obey, if you start getting idolatrous, you will be scattered to the nations. There was that warning. And a lot of times, you know, the prophets, it's not so much that they're prophesying, making up new things and foretelling the future, but really they're just enforcing what the law had already said. If you obey, you will be blessed. If you disobey, you know, you will be eventually taken into captivity. Or I think of the prophet Jeremiah. Now, Jeremiah warned Israel 23 years he was warning them. Watch out. Turn back. Repent. It's always a come back to me. Come back. Turn from your evil ways and things will go well for you. Or I think of well, as we've got a scripture here. Hopefully we can see it in Chronicles, the chronicler. I'm going to try to get some water here. Thank you for your patience. He explained it very well, the cause of this captivity. We will get to the book of Daniel in a second here. 2 Chronicles 36, the Lord, the God of their fathers, sent persistently to them by His messengers because He had compassion on His people. It wasn't out of looking for wrath. It wasn't looking to punish them. It was His compassion. Because He had compassion on His people and His dwelling place. But they kept mocking the messengers of God. God is going after them with everlasting love. But they kept mocking them, despising His words, scoffing at His prophets. Mocking, despising, scoffing until the wrath of God rose against His people. Until there was no remedy. And so when we get into the book of Daniel, you've got to realize where they were. We always try to get into the historic context, what was going on in that season. And I'll show you a map here. Hopefully we can see that as well. They had to walk in that captivity. You see, they went from Jerusalem all the way to Babylon. It was probably about 1,000 miles just walking. Not a car, not an airplane. I'm originally from Minnesota. I think up to from here to Minneapolis is probably about 900 miles. It'd take us 2 days. If we could do it in a day, but that's a long day. That's a long day. Now walking, they do 30 miles a day. That's going to be long, and that's a good walk. 20 miles maybe. children, other things. That's a long walk. And you know, Babel, you go back into the book of Genesis, and there was this group of people, Genesis chapter 11. They said, let's build a tower that reaches up to the sky. Let's make a name for ourselves. You can see Babylon, God had to come along. He confused their language. He said, you know, kind of like they're so united now. They're not doing my plan, because I wanted them to be dispersed. I wanted them to fill the earth, but they just want to, and then they want to make a name for themselves. Babel, confusion. And then you look at Babylon, really the antithesis of the kingdom of God, antithesis of Jerusalem, even the new Jerusalem. In a couple of weeks, if you can come, we'll talk in chapter 4 of Daniel, and you'll hear about Nebuchadnezzar that said, look at this great kingdom that I've built for my glory, through my power, for my majesty. Now that's Babylon, you know, and the book of Revelation talks about two cities. There's the New Jerusalem coming down. That's the church. That's the people of God. That's the beauty. That's the holiness. And then there's Babylon. In the garden, there were two trees. There was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That was the forbidden fruit. And then there was the tree of life. And you can see throughout Scripture this contrast between the kingdom of God, Jerusalem, Babylon. There's two roads that you can, two paths. The broad road that leads to destruction, many people on that. The narrow road that leads to life. There were two groups of five virgins that were wise. They had oil. Five virgins that were unwise. They didn't have oil. There were two builders. Matthew chapter 7, I think it's in Luke chapter 6 as well. There are two builders. Both of them hear the word of God. One of them does according to what he hears. The other one hears, does not do. The storms of life come. The rivers come. The flooding comes. The one who hears the word of God is solid. His life is built upon the rock. The rock is Jesus. He's obeying Jesus. The other one, the foolish builder, you can see that those contrasts throughout Scripture. Jesus gave parables as well. The parable of there was a dragnet that was cast out and there was fish, and then they had to separate the good fish from the bad fish. Or the parable of the sheep and the goats. At the end, when the Son of Man comes and there's a judgment time, there'll be the sheep on the right, the goats on the left. There's, again, that contrast throughout. And so I did want to just bring that out when we talk about Babylon. And you've got to be able to see that a little bit. Now, Nebuchadnezzar, the king, he sought to assimilate the people into his culture. And so even with the Jews that were taken captive, he even changed their identity, changed their name. So you can see our friends, Daniel, you know, these names, they have meanings to them. My name, Philip, is lover of horses. My wife's is Edith, rich gift. Peter, the rock. Simon, he was the reed that was kind of breakable and unstable. And Moses, the one that was taken out of the river. You know, Jacob, the deceiver. Abram, exalted father. And then his name was changed to Abraham, the father of a multitude. But if you look at Daniel, that's his Hebrew name. I think we can pull this up. God is my judge. And then Nebuchadnezzar comes along and says, no, your name is not going to be that according to your God. Your name is going to be according to my God. Changes his very identity. Belshazzar, old lady, wife of the god Bel, protect the king. Hananiah, that would be Shadrach. We know him kind of more by Shadrach. Hananiah, Yahweh is gracious. Shadrach, at the command of Aku, the moon god. So the Babylon, they've got all these false gods as well, and they put their names. Mishael, we don't know who that is. We know Shadrach, Meshach, who is like Aku. Azariah, who's that? Abednego, the servant of the shining one. So he's, you know, this Nebuchadnezzar, this king of Babylon, He's trying to assimilate everybody. You're going to be like me. You're going to be under my power. You're going to be under my kingdom. You're going to do what I say. And so let's get into this. Now we're going to get into the scripture here. Daniel 3 and verse 1. And we're going to talk about that a little bit. Daniel 3, 1. King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits. That'd be about 90 feet. Its breadth was 6 cubits. That's about 9 feet. He set it up on the plain of Dura at the province of Babylon. It might have been something like this next picture. It might have been. I don't really know. That's just, you know, you can look it up. You can get different pictures. There are dictators who will make statues of themselves, put them all over the country, let them know kind of who's in charge. And I don't know, maybe it's just a nerdy kind of geeky thing that I did. I tried to figure it out. I'll say it's 90 feet high, and if it's, you know, 9 feet wide. And I don't know, I was just curious, you know, if solid gold. And some of that gold really might have been taken from Solomon's temple. You know, could very well have been. Solomon had 666 talents of gold that came to him every year. 666. First time that appears. It's just a side note. He wasn't supposed to accumulate gold. He wasn't supposed to accumulate wives. He's supposed to depend upon the Lord for his army as well. Just a little side, you know. So he's already leaning. He's like. But anyway, I looked at 90 feet high, and I'm just kind of curious, you know, what is that? How solid would that be? You know, so if you go back to, I don't know, fifth grade geometry class, you can figure out the size of a cone. You know, so if it's 9 feet base, 90 feet high, you know, the radius and then the height, the third of that, you got that pi, 3.14 in there too, you know, something like that. And then you figure out the weight of the gold, how much gold weighs. You just get you to do all that kind of math. And then, hey, Siri, how much is gold worth today? And then you multiply that all out. And so this is just a guesstimate, because if it was I did it like a cone, but if it was a statue, like a person, you know, that's going to be different, but just an estimate. Price of gold today, and it came out to $86 billion worth of gold. And I'm thinking about that, and you know, we like it or not, we do live in a sense in a Babylon. There's different expressions of Babylon. There's different expressions, like King Nebuchadnezzar said. He said, look at this great kingdom that I've built by my power for the glory of my majesty. And I can even walk out to my backyard on my deck, and I can, you know, my wife does the flowers, and I try to do the grass, and we try to keep, and I can walk out there, and I can say, look at this great yard that I have for the glory of my, and your little kingdom might be pretty small, but you could say, look at this great. And I think about the society in which we live. How does Babylon express itself? Now, one of the ways in our culture is through sports. Also entertainment. We could talk about social media. Let's talk about sports for a little bit. Now, I used to play football, American football. I lived in Costa Rica as a missionary for 12 years. Didn't watch any football. It's all soccer. And so I come back here to Nashville, and I'm watching a football game, American football, for the first time in like 10 or 12 years. And you know, every year the NFL has different small rule changes. There's two or three. Add that up over 10 or 12 years, and it's like, wow, what? I'm watching it like one of these international students that had never. I used to play in high school. And so, just out of curiosity, how much is the NFL worth now? The cumulative value of all the 32 teams would be $163 billion. Now, should there be Christians in the NFL? Should there? Yes. We have members of our church. I actually talked to one of the members of our church who plays, and I said, hey, I'm going to talk about Babylon. I'm going to compare. He said, yeah, I like it, because you get in there and it's look at me. And it's not that Christians shouldn't be in that Babylon expression. We should be light, but we should be well aware of what we... I'm thinking about Daniel. We kind of joke around because there was one time he said, you know, he comes from Chicago, home of the six-time NBA world champions. And of course, I had to look it up again. And I had to look it up because I'm from Minnesota, home of the original Minneapolis Lakers, now known as Los Angeles Lakers, 17-time. Look at this great, look at this dynasty, look at this Babel, look at this. You know, that's just sports. Maybe you're not into sports. Maybe you're into like social media. And so, I mean, look how much, you know, Facebook, what is that? You know, that might be the oldest. It might be the longest. You know, how much is it worth? And it, something like 1.19 trillion. Look at this great. And think about social media, whatever the social media is. Now, should we be on it? I was thinking about this. Because they asked me to do a little video to kind of promote the Wednesday night. So I'm promoting the Wednesday. So I did my little 20-second, 30-second video. So I was on social media this afternoon. Should we be there? Yes, we should. We should be light. However, let's be well aware. This can be a, look at how many followers I have. Look at how many likes I have. Look at this little kingdom. The thing about social media is... they give each person an opportunity to build their own little Babylon. Should we be there? Yes, we should. But be well aware where you are. Be well aware where you are. Let's just continue here. We'll get down here a little bit. We'll get back to the scriptures here. Daniel chapter 3, verse 4. Daniel 3, 4. And so they made this declaration. They had this new law. The herald proclaimed aloud, "You are commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages." That combination there, remember Babel, the Tower of Babel, the confusion of the languages. Just a little bit ago, we celebrated Pentecost Sunday, the reverse of that. "O peoples, nations, and languages, that when you hear the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the bagpipe, and every kind of music, you are to fall down and worship the golden image that the king Nebuchadnezzar has set up." See, that's what Babylon does. Whatever that expression, you know, it might even be, you know, and again, we do pray for our governing authorities. We're called to pray for our civil authorities. They are in positions of legitimate authority. But like any fallen institution, because there's fallen people in it, it can become as well that attitude, that mentality of, "We're going to be your savior." Or people can look to the government instead of looking to God to be their savior. "You must fall down and worship what we proclaim to be the new policy, even the new identity. You must." And so we're in this Babylon. Should Christians, yes, we should be light in the midst of the darkness. And any one of these, academia, the arts, any one of these can become if we have the wrong attitude, but we are to be salt and light in that. So here was the decree. You have to fall down. When we play this music, you have to fall down and worship. "And whoever does not fall down and worship shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace." We're gonna fire you if you don't worship the way we worship. That's not exactly what they say, but that's what they're saying. Let's jump down to verse 16. "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, it'd be better to say, Yahweh is gracious. Who is what God is? Yahweh is my helper." That's like when you talk about Abraham. "What's your name? Father of a multitude." Well, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Okay. "They answered the king and they said, O King Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. He will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, even if he doesn't, be it known to you, king, we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar was filled with fury, and the expression of his face was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times more than it was usually heated. just think about that. Just 7. That's a number of perfection, number of... Who's really in charge here? And so they throw him in. And the people throwing him in die because it's so hot. Verse 24. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and rose up in haste. You can feel the tension. You really got to feel those words that they're saying. Let's not just read it quick, but he rose up in haste. Wait a minute. Rose up in haste. So what's going on here? He declared to his counselors, hey guys, didn't we cast 3 men bound into the fire? They answered and said to the king, true, O king. He answered and said, but I see 4 men unbound walking in the midst of the fire. They're not hurt. And the appearance of the 4th is like the son of the gods. Now, who was that 4th man? Who was that? A lot of people would like to believe that it could very well have been. Could very well have been a Christophany, a physical appearance of Christ before his incarnation. It doesn't specifically say, but we do believe that Jesus existed before all things were made by him, for him, created an angel. You know, even when it says the angel of the Lord, not an angel, you know, that again, you know, use your sanctified imagination a little bit. And I think the eternality of Jesus, his pre-existence, goes beyond our ability to comprehend that God would become a man in Christ Jesus. Yes, born of a Virgin Mary, came into the world as a baby. Now, how does that all, it's just like the Trinity, 3 in 1, 1 God, 3 persons, each is God, but yet there is 1 God. It's like, wow, it just blows my mind. But let's think now, Jesus, did he have to deal with Babylon? Even when he was a little baby, even in the Christmas story, there was another king, Herod, wanted to kill him. You can see that competition, that, you know, those contrary kingdoms. There's this new king. Who's this little baby? The wise men come, and Herod, he just wants to kill him. You know, when Jesus is tempted, the first temptation, if you're the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. And then it says, the devil showed him all the kingdoms of this earth and their glory. So that would be beyond just Babylon, Roman Empire, Byzantine Empire, NFL Empire, all these other empires. I mean, all of them. You can have all of this. And what did he say? You shall serve the Lord your God only. Him alone shall you worship. Or what about when Jesus, you know, when he fed the 5,000, John chapter 6, and then later and it says, I'm the bread of life. But when he multiplied the fish and the bread, the people saw what had happened. They saw it. And then it says, Jesus, perceiving in his heart that they wanted to come and make him king by force. You can become king right now. You can have it right now. What did he do? No, he backed off. He said, no, that's not for me. That's not my time. That's not my time. He had all the popularity. He'd just done a great miracle. Of course they would want Jesus. Yeah, you can feed 5,000. You can take care of our needs. Which is kind of what we want. We want God to take care of our needs, but then we want to live however we want to live. Or what about, you know, the triumphal entry? So there, Jesus, I imagine the disciples are like, yeah, this is it, baby. I mean, he's coming in. He's going to take over. He's going right up, and he's going to kick all the Romans out. Triumphal entry, Palm Sunday. And what does Jesus do? Goes to the temple and kicks out the money changers. That was not what they had expected. Or I think even you know, in Acts, after Jesus' death and resurrection, he's about to go to heaven, and the disciples, they're just like us sometimes. They just don't get it. Lord, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel right now? Are we going to have our... Now, that's not for you to know. You don't know the times and the seasons that the Father has set on his own accord. But you shall receive power. You be my witnesses. Did Jesus have to deal with Babylon? That expression in his generation? Definitely. Would Jesus have been a fourth man in the fire? I think of Jesus when Peter was walking on the water and Peter got his eyes off of Jesus and he started to sink. It wasn't the fourth man in the fire, it was the hand that pulled him up. Don't you just love Jesus? I think about the woman caught in adultery. They bring this woman, because you always kind of wonder, where's the man? But they bring the woman, and they said, Jesus, this woman was caught in the very act. The law says we should stone such a one. That woman was in the fire. And she maybe wasn't as innocent as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. However, the fourth man in the fire. So Jesus starts to write on the sand a little bit. This is John chapter 8. He starts to write on the sand. He looks up and he says, everybody, if any of you don't have any sin, who's ever perfect, you go ahead, throw the first stone. They started leaving. Then Jesus looked at the woman. It's just those two. He would have been the one with no sin. Where are your accusers? Nobody accuses you? Neither do I. Go and sin no more. That's our Jesus. That's our rescuer. That's the one I asked for that last song. We kind of call it the special ops song. You know, I'll break down any wall, you know, climb up any mountain. That's our Jesus. I mean, he's going after us because we needed it saving. Or I also think about, you know, when they tried to bring children to Jesus. And one of the, I think it's Mark, that Jesus rebuked him. He was indignant that they would not allow the children to come. It's like he was mad. Could you imagine a little child watching that? I mean, here's this little kid, and his parents are bringing, we're going to give you to bring Jesus. He's just going to bless you. He's going to lay his. And then the disciples, they're like, no, Jesus is too busy. That little child, he's probably just intimidated. But there is one. Fourth man in the fire for that little child, straightening things out. No, let the children come. That little child went from trauma to, I'm in the hands of Jesus. You know, when I see like my son and my son-in-law with their children, with their little children, I see Jesus. When I see Pastor James dealing with little children, I see Jesus. In that moment, fourth man in the fire for the vulnerable. That's our Jesus. You know, in the actual scripture, you know, the fourth man in the fire, it doesn't say this is Jesus. But if you look at who Jesus is, the greatest one I like is the scripture that it says, Romans chapter 5, verse 8, but God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That fourth man in the fire. And we were not that innocent. Not at all. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Let's go back to Daniel chapter 3. Because as I look out on the congregation, as I look and consider people that might be watching online. People are going through fire. People are going through difficulty. And whether you are as the woman caught in adultery, where you are guilty, as we all have been in different moments, and trials come upon us because of our own foolishness, our own guilt, or if you are as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and you're just standing for righteousness. I think that as we stand for righteousness, something similar to what Nebuchadnezzar observed and said will happen with those around us. Daniel 3:28, Nebuchadnezzar answered and said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants, who trusted in him, set aside the king's command. Set aside my command is what he's saying. and yielded up their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree. Here's Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, the antithesis of the city of God, Jerusalem, antithesis of the kingdom of God. Therefore, I make a decree. Any people, nation, or language that speaks anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be, that's pretty strong here, shall be torn limb from limb, their houses laid in ruins. For there is no other God who is able to rescue in this way. And I do believe that as we stand strong, as we don't bow down to the Babylon that surrounds us. You want to be wise? Yes. But there will be a moment where you'll have to choose between just being wise and following along the current and being strong and not bowing down to the Babylon in your surroundings. But when we do that, people will praise God when they see that he is with us, when we don't bow down to the worldly idols. One last scripture, and then I'm going to ask, I don't know, Pastor Bryson, Pastor Dave, either one of you could come up to pray for us. 1 Peter 4, beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial. Don't be surprised. Just don't be surprised. Welcome to being a follower of Jesus. Welcome to being a disciple. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings. Share Christ's sufferings. Even the Roman centurion, when he saw Christ suffer, this has to be the Son of God. There's something special. We can share Christ's sufferings so that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, have you been insulted? You're blessed because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. You're blessed. Don't be surprised. Stand strong. Don't bow down. We don't always see our deliverance. God doesn't always deliver us from the fire, but he's with us in the fire. He's with us in the fire. And when he's with us in the fire, other people will see that. It's not just about our comfort. It's about the glory of God. Pastor Dave.
What a great word. Yeah, you can give God praise for that. I want us to take just a pause. Pastor Phillip's given us such a compelling picture. I was scribbling notes as fast as I could. I had more things I'm going to write down after. I think I need some time to settle in on this idea of Babylon, the desire to grab glory for ourselves, the desire to have more power, more influence, more admiration, to go against the glory of God by fighting for the glory of ourselves this different way. But where Pastor Phillip took us to the end is where I think God's been asking us as a family to sit and listen and pay attention. As I'm thinking through the last week, we're being reminded that even though he's good and gracious and kind, he will allow us to face a trial. Even though he has promises for us, there is something we're going to have to persevere through. He's gracious. He's good. He's loving. He has more for us at the end of that than we could ever imagine or quantify or count. And it will endure beyond anything we could ever find a way to grasp with our finite minds. And yet, in the moment, right now, I imagine some of you are going through a trial. As one friend was texting me today, he's going through a trial of deep loneliness, just feels terribly alone. I'm so glad he reached out. I'm reaching back out as often as I can. You are not alone. That's one form of a trial. Some of you have the trial of children that aren't living for God or are actively mocking you and what you believe or what you think. Some of you are going through relational trials. Relationships that were very important to you, fractured or broken. Financial trials. But some of you have received direct persecution, although it's mild forms perhaps compared to what you receive in other countries for your faith. At work, you're afraid. In your neighborhood, you're concerned. I've heard some of those stories. This last verse, do not be surprised at the fiery trial you'll face. I don't want to have to tell my kids that. Welcome to being Christian. You're going to face a trial. Welcome to being Christian. You're going to suffer. There's going to be pain. Welcome to being Christian. You're going to be mocked, made fun of. Welcome to being Christian. One day you might be fired just because you love Jesus. Welcome to being Christian. But it's true. The promise, though, in this sermon is no matter what the fiery trial is, there's another in the fire. That's the promise, right? If we're faithful and refuse to bend our knee, even at pain or persecution, rejection, pressure, there's another in the fire. And he will be glorified. And he will be faithful to us. If not in this life, this is what I think those three young men had a glimpse of, then in the life to come. And they didn't have the promises we have, so they just said, well, if not, I'm still not bending my knee because I know where my faith is. Would you stand with me as we come towards the close of our service tonight? Just take a moment in prayer. Bow your heads. Is there a trial you're facing? If there is, just lift your hands to him. Some of you already did it. I didn't even say it. You just started praying. It says that holy men and women everywhere should lift with holy hands lifted. Just lift your hands to him. And that's a way of you saying, God, I've got a trial. See me. We've been talking about the God who sees on Sunday. See me right now. I'm in a trial. There's pressure. There's difficulty. There's fear. There's pain. There's loss. Lord, see me. But even more than that, be with me. Be that fourth man in the fire. In Peter's story, you're the first man in the water. In this story, you're the fourth man in the fire. Whichever one it is, if I'm drowning, be there. Lift me up. If I'm in the middle of the heat, walk there with me. Shield me from it. Carry me through it. Lord, we turn to you right now. And we ask you to see us in each of the trials that we're facing. I don't think it was an accident. Now that I've heard the sermon, that we paused before the sermon to pray for a particular trial. Lord, whatever that trial is we're going through, we lift it to you now and we entrust you with it. I lift my own. You know what they are. You know how they weigh me. You're a good God. And Lord, we together today as a spiritual family, we proclaim we won't bend our knee. We won't bend our knee to Babylon. We won't bend our knee to self-seeking glory. We won't bend our knee to conspicuous gathering of ridiculous wealth at the cost of other people's livelihood and well-being. We won't bend our knee to the addictive, compulsive chasing of pleasure, no matter what it costs and loses other people or harms others. We won't bend our knee to the spectacle. We won't bend our knee to the show. We won't bend our knee. We may even have to be in a show, but we won't bend our knee to Babylon. Lord, help us. Make us a light in this place. And we'll give you thanks, we'll give you glory, and we'll tell the story of it from generation to generation. In Jesus' name, Amen.